listen to the album.
I mean, I had a great tune. I loved it. And then
I don't know what it means, but it's pretty.
And it melted into the, what we didn't want to do.
Who are we killing now?
We're pretty much on a blank canvas.
So what do you want to know?
Some people like to rock, some people like to roll.
I just thought it was time to do it, you know. It's something I've been looking forward to doing for a long time. I've been promising myself I would do it. Ever since the 50s, I think, you know, just I must get round to that. And a lot of songs that we didn't do with the Beatles. In the early days, we started doing kind of B-sides and stuff to make sure that other bands couldn't copy us. Because otherwise, if we did stuff right out of the charts, everyone knew it and they'd go on before us and often do half our act. So we started looking for... So I had a big collection of B-sides and odd songs off albums and things, some of which, like Hippie Hippie Shake and stuff we did with the Beatles, didn't necessarily come out. They'd come out on the Beatles anthology thing. And then some of which I never got around to doing. I just loved them. So I thought, before the 20th century is out, I've got to do my rock and roll album. And it was also something that Linda was very into. She said, you've got to do that. I go out there, and the guy says, he's got the Rasta guy up against the car. The Rasta guy's going, all right, go on, man, what are you going to do, knock me out? I'm thinking, oh, come on, guys, calm down. I'm in. I'd heard the Buddy Holly recording, but I should have known, because it's so obvious, Chuck Berry's song, really. I mean, who else would write the lines, "Seen last year, the world in the palm of our hands," and, you know, and it's supposed to be Vino de Milo, Venus de Milo, or Vino de Miling, who knows?
Run, devil, run, the angels having fun, making winners out of sinners, better leave me boys done.
big mohair suit. He's great. And I got to know him a little bit later, you know, when we worked in Hamburg. We got to hang out with him, and he's a great person. Classic, you know. Telly on and played a bit of pool and stuff, but just talking, just being near him was enough for us. You know, we were such major fans. It was really just that one moment was enough for me, meeting him actually personally, one-on-one, as a guy. You know, there was nobody around, as I recall. There were a couple of his mates, a couple of his sort of minders, playing pool at the back, kind of just like biking mates. But it was mainly us and him, you know, so it was really cool. It was just like hanging around with one of the mates. So that was so special. I never really wanted to spoil it during this period where we went very fat and rhinestone. I just wasn't too keen to spoil the memory. I mean, you know, a lot of people think he was still great then. I think he was great. But I cherished his young period, really, sort of when I really idolised him.
Wrong, didn't I? Been a long time. This is so informal, we'll start again. Well, a few more woohoos, yeah!
Hey, wait a minute, what is the word?
Do I have to? I got it.
One, two, three, four. Try to see it.
It is amazing, you know, just suddenly you do think, God, you know, there were only four Beatles, and I was one of them. I am one of those four. Just kind of staggering. But in a way, you don't let yourself see that. It's sort of, he was one of the Beatles. I think, you know, if you get too into it, you blow your mind. You just think, wow, you know. So you keep a little bit of distance, and you're just very happy that it was you and you were there. I'm very chuffed with what we did. The funniest thing, though, for the Beatles always was, we're the only people who never saw the Beatles. You know, we were on stage being them. We'd often look around and say, it must be great being there. Screaming and, yeah, and, you know, hearing Twist and Shout and seeing John do that. I'm like, I can't even see him because I've got to look this way, look that way, and he'll get off mic. So it was an interesting thing for us. But it was beautiful. It was great. Good group. We wanted to develop musically, you know, and all that happened. And as it happened now, luckily, 30 years on from it, we're still very influential. It still is a very influential group. It still means a lot in terms of liberty to people. You know, I meet people from Russia, from Bosnia, and all over the place, you know. I say, it was your group, man. You know, we made us realize you could have a life, you know, because they were pretty constricted. It was quite stiff before the 60s. You know, there was a lot of, you must do this. And it's, you know, some people say it's opened up a bit too much, but I'd rather have that than sort of China. You know, and that sort of repression. So to be part of all of that, be part of all this sort of peace movement, and a lot of good things have been happening, and musically, you know. So I'm very pleased, well chuffed, actually. You know, it's great. I say, we didn't look for that to happen. We didn't plan it that way. And I think that's what actually makes it even more fun. Why do you see it in your way? I was remembering the favourite period of recording of everything, mainly with the Beatles. There was this time in the early days, round about Revolver and Rubber Soul, a couple of Beatles' early albums, when you used to just go in on a specific schedule. You used to have to come in 10 o'clock, be ready to work at 10:30, 10:30 till 1:30, do two songs, 1:30 to 2:30, lunch, 2:30 to 5:30, two more songs. So if you stuck to that, and then you went to the pub, which is like really civilized. You know, you didn't have to stay all evening and miss the pictures or not be able to go to dinner or anything. You know, you still had a life with that schedule. So I thought it was so good, and I remembered working with the Beatles and how fast we worked and how cool it was. You had to have ideas quickly. It was like a problem. You couldn't, you know, labor over it for days. How are we gonna? It was like, quick, come on. You just had to solve it, which is such a better way of working, you know. It's like nothing's that important, you know, that we're gonna spend 5 hours on it. So you just dashed it all off, and I think it kind of showed, the excitement showed in the music. So I thought, if the band's up, much more excited and much more on the ball, if we're doing it kind of quickly. I started with a guitar, I started with bass. I thought, well, what I'll do is I'll play bass and nothing but that. I played actually one little bit of guitar, but mainly I was bass player and singer, which is what I did in the Beatles. And I knew I would sing and play at the same time, which again, you don't normally do these days. You keep them separate for separation, give yourself all the options. But I thought, sod it, you know, I'll just do it. If it's no good, it's no good, that's all. Junk it if it's no good. So I did that, so I knew the bass player and the vocalist. Then I knew Dave Gilmour was great and a mate. So I saw if he was available, and Mickey Green. I thought the two of them would be a great combination. So I knew them and I'd worked with them before. But I hadn't worked with Pete Wingfield, the pianist. But I knew he'd had that record, 18 with a Bullet, so I knew he had a good studio head. I knew he'd be at ease in a studio. And everyone I talked to said he's just a brilliant rock and roll pianist, which he turned out to be. So he was a guess, really. And I just sort of said, you know, he's so highly recommended by everyone, I thought, yeah, I'm just gonna take a risk. And similarly with Ian Paice, who I knew from, I didn't know him personally, but I knew his work from Deep Purple. So I knew he was a great drummer. And Chris Thomas, the producer on the record, said, I saw a bit of telly on him a week or two ago. He said he's really playing great still, and he's on the ball, and he just looks like the man for the job. Run, devil, run, the angels having fun, making winners out of sinners, better leave me boys done. So he was a guest, and I didn't meet either of those two guys till the Monday morning at 10 o'clock, literally. Hello. Who are you? I'm your drummer. But it was great. It was kind of more exciting that way, actually. And he rang up the week before, and he said, what songs are we going to do? You know, I'd like to do a little bit of homework. And we said, I'm not telling. There's no homework on this project. You know, this is just fun. So there's the way we treated it. And then Pete, the pianist, would come in and he'd say, I think I can maybe do that solo better. We'd say, you're kidding, that's great, and that's perfect for rock and roll. He said, but I think I could do the left hand a bit better. Maybe. We said, Pete, you're thinking. He'd go, oh, yeah. So, like, we banned thinking from the week, you know. Nobody was allowed to think too hard about anything. So it made it a nice week, you know, it was like a holiday almost. Very casual, really. It's not like we are sort of a band who just got signed up, who sort of got a gig. It's more some people have got together to sort of make this rock and roll record. So if a gig comes up, as it occasionally does, we did one in Los Angeles for PETA, the people for the ethical treatment of animals, which is really nice to do, and for the cause, the animal cause, was a great thing to do it for. But that was a really blinder of a little gig. We only did half a dozen numbers, which was nice. You know, it's a bit of a doss, but it was really good to do. We all loved it.
We're flying through the desert in a TWA. I saw a woman walking across the sand. She been walking 30 miles a route to Bombay to meet a brown-eyed handsome man. The submission was a brown-eyed handsome man. Way back in history, 3,000 years, and ever since the world began, there's been a whole lot of good when we shed it tears.
I'm very proud of the album, you know, it's a sort of rock and roll album. It's got a good modern sound, although the songs are old-fashioned. But a lot of them people haven't heard, so they might as well be new songs. Some of them, you know, like No Other Baby. It's kind of got a sort of contemporary thing to it in a way. So it's nice, it's just worked out well in a very kind of sort of rough, casual way. You know, it's not been a sweat, that's for sure. Known when you'd want to stop. I suppose there's a point you just get fed up, but I've never really reached that point yet. I keep expecting it, maybe next year. But I still have a lot of fascination for it, a lot of love for it, a lot of excitement, a lot of energy to do it. You know, I keep expecting it not to be there. And maybe that's part of the secret. Maybe if you expect it, oh, it's going any second. Maybe it doesn't go quite so quick, you know what I mean? Sometimes you don't make so much of it. I don't really worry about it. It's like, you know, I'll retire, I'll go on holiday, you know, travel, all the things you plan to do. For the time being, I just love music. I could be a lot less busy. You know, it's my call. I could just go off on holiday right now. In fact, I think I will. See you, Mike.